culturally acceptable to do that. My name is Lorenzo Vidino. I'm the director of the program on extremism. I'm very happy that we're hosting this event today. I want to welcome you to the GW. Very important event. We're very happy to try to have a good, conducive, constructive discussion on a topic that gets a lot of people very interested, very animated at times, the Muslim Brotherhood. We had an event on the same topic last year. We had the opportunity of hosting Sir John Jenkins, who was the ambassador that led the British government review in 2014 on the Muslim Brotherhood. It gave us the perspective of how, probably the only case in which a Western government conducted a year-long review of a crucial, important movement, how they did it. It was the time when there was a conversation, at least in the U.S., about designating the Brotherhood as a terrorist organization, and we thought that perspective was very, very important and very balanced in what is, as I said, a very heated debate. We are having an event today, partially because we had the opportunity of having Martin Frampton here, who published, I don't have a copy with me, but you saw the copies outside of the monumental work that Martin put. How many pages is it?
Six.
We're a couple of hundreds of pages of footnotes. Yeah, it's a bit of a show off, but the book is excellent. I've been going through it. It's the product of years and years of archival research and interviews, and it's really, I would say, the definitive story of the relationship between the U.S. And the U.K. in particular, and the product is possibly Martin to talk more about it. So the event today is, that's sort of the hook for this conversation today, is Martin's book. Martin is a professor at Queen Mary University, has been studying the issue for a long time. He'll present the book. Then we're going to have Mohamed Ali Atraoui, who's a French scholar, been in town, Georgetown, for the last few months. Very glad that he's joined us here, Mohamed, for a long time. It's very, very good to see him on this side of the pond. He's been also studying the Brotherhood for a long time, has a project going on about policy implications, again, policy relations between the foreign policy of Islamist movements. So very much related to the topic. I will then bring in my two cents, not a Middle East expert. I've done a bit of work on the Brotherhood in the West, and I think that's an important aspect of that. And Martin's book is about the Brotherhood and the West. I think there's a very related conversation to have about the Muslim Brotherhood in the West and the presence here. And then I think the idea is to open it to questions, and we have a small audience, so I think it would be very conducive to a good conversation about it. Without further ado, Martin, all you.
Yeah, thanks Lorenzo. And thanks to Lorenzo, Alex, and the wider team here at George Washington for hosting me. It's a particular honor to share a platform with Lorenzo, whose own work, it's too modest to say, but his own work on brotherhood related groups is, I think, essential reading in understanding how the movement has evolved within a Western context. And certainly, I hope my work, in a way, sort of dovetails in with some of the themes he has explored. And I'm also really grateful to have a chance to sit with Mohamed and also to hear about his work, which I think, again, sort of folds into to some of the things I'm going to talk about and that I explore. As Lorenzo has said, great detail in the book. I clearly have an editor who's far too tolerant and didn't say no enough when I said, oh, can we just add this bit in? Can we just... So the book, it did get rather long. So I apologize for that. But of course, I would say it makes a great present. So do go out and buy lots of copies. It's available outside to purchase. I'll also say I'm sorry that if I'm not at my most articulate. I'm here in the US with my wife and young son, come abroad for the first time. And my son decided that last night was a great night for waking up at 3 a.m. for 2 hours and crying. So I feel slightly bedraggled and exhausted, but I will do my best to present my ideas in as coherent a fashion as possible. Why did I decide to write this book? Firstly, because I think the Muslim Brotherhood remains arguably, I think, the most influential Islamist movement in the world. So I think in and of itself, it's an interesting movement to explore, and I got interested in the Brotherhood as a movement over 10 years ago now. I should say originally, I'm a scholar actually of Northern Ireland, and it seems very removed from this kind of subject matter, but I guess the sort of the theme, hopefully, in my work is kind of the way in which non-state movements relate to Western governments, how they try and respond, what is and the way in which they frame a particular mode of politics. And I won't get into this now, but I think some interesting analogies of the Brotherhood at the moment's formation and the Irish movement that I will want to study, Sinn Féin. But as I said, that's another story, really, but that's kind of how I got into this. So I think the Brotherhood is important and will remain so. Secondly, I think this fact alone means that its relationship with the West is very important. And here I will add my caveat that when I talk about the West in this setting, I'm talking primarily about the British and the American governments. So it will actually be interesting to hear if Mohammed's work touches on this, but perhaps more of a French perspective on this. The reason I did this, the reason I focused on the West as meaning the British and the Americans, was because I think in the Egyptian and in the wider Middle Eastern context, historically, they are the two most important external players. And I think, therefore, that relationship is a kind of critical one. And if you look, it's very valuable insights from the work of people like Jason Brownlee, which look at the role of Western governments as effectively a key part of the ruling dynamic, the configuration of power in countries like Egypt. Put the microphone on. Hopefully, not gave me anyway. So that's kind of why the second reason why I thought this was worth exploring. Thirdly, the third reason why I wrote this book was I just kind of became fascinated in the subject as one replete with conspiracy theories, kind of from all directions. These conspiracy theories about the relationship between the Brotherhood and the West, kind of coming from all angles. Throughout the history of the Brotherhood, going back to the 20s and the early 30s, its enemies have accused it of being the cat's paw of various foreign powers, the English, Zionists, communists, the Americans, latterly. And I would argue that if you look at what happened after 2011, it sort of reaches a crescendo in that period. And I sort of lay out some of this in the introduction to the book. There you have liberals and secularists and nationalists in the Egyptian context accusing the Brotherhood of essentially being an agent of Western power, of Ann Patterson in particular is playing a very nefarious role in sort of elevating the Brotherhood into power in Egypt. And this takes quite a graphic and vitriolic form in places. As I say, those of the kind of Nasserist persuasion, nationalists are especially fond of that view. But also, I think you've seen here in the US as well, sections of the right, famously around people like Frank Gaffney, have accused the Brotherhood of exercising a particularly powerful hold over the Obama administration. So this notion of kind of conspiracy theories, kind of hidden agendas, working in this case to the advantage of the Brotherhood, have proved quite potent. Ironically, of course, even as this case was being made, there's been a strong enduring current through the Brotherhood's own history of its members arguing that the West was allied to its enemies and working to do down the Brotherhood and continue to prevent it from achieving power. Again, this takes various forms. One of the most interesting ones that I'd like to do a bit more work on, actually, in recent years has been the notion of what gets called the sort of the Bernard Lewis plan to sort of allegedly divide the Middle East, this notion that British historian, Orientalist scholar Bernard Lewis is somehow kind of exercising this malign influence over the US Congress and has got it to work to divide up the Middle East and divide up Egypt in particular. I think it's four statelets, you see different versions of it. And the map, I was very interested in the maps of these kind of things, how the map is going to be redrawn. But at the heart of it is this notion of kind of malign undercurrent of Western power working to do down the Muslim world and in particular to do down the Brotherhood itself. And various Brotherhood newspapers, websites, blogs, you will see this kind of thinking reoccur. So everywhere you look, I think conspiracy theories abound on this issue and the question of what has been the relationship between the Brotherhood and the West. And so this is what I wanted to unpick in the book. And so the book really sort of tries to do this empirically, historically, and I look at the period from the creation of the Brotherhood in 1928 down to 2010. Why do I stop in 2010, you might say, given what I just said, and am I sort of not missing a kind of key part of the story? Well, I am a historian, so I do try to attain some temporal detachment from the world that I look on, as well as subjectively. And also, I just had a sense as well that after 2010, as you move into the period of the Arab Revolutions, the upheavals, there was almost just kind of too many moving parts. Secondly, of course, you know, it's just useful to leave it out there for a publisher to say, why don't you write the next volume after what happens after 2011? So that was kind of a more cynical view, perhaps, of why not to do it. But on a serious note, I would say, yeah, this is very much a work of history, looking at what's going on in the period between the 20s down to 2010. Also, I think, you know, such is the nature of the upheavals in 2011, this is a kind of a crucial caesura, dividing line. And I would finally add as well that I think even despite that, I think the book and the issues I'm looking at, this does actually explain, the story down to 2010 actually explains some of the things that happen after 2011 as well. So we can detect and identify key phenomena, key trends which point to the way in which actors on all sides really behave in the period after 2011. So that's kind of my introduction for what I'm talking about. Apologise as well if I occasionally press my phone. I'm not expecting an urgent call. I just don't have a watch, so it's my only way of keeping time. So I'll just try and lay out some of the main issues that I explored and looked at in the book, some of the main points I raised. Firstly, I hope the book offers an important insight into a particular strand of Anglo-American foreign policy making, which is particularly applicable to the Middle East, but I think also ranges more broadly. What I mean by this is that one of the themes of the book is the way in which a particular language of diplomacy, is the phrase I use, a particular language of diplomacy occurs and reoccurs at regular intervals. And at the heart of this language is a paradigm that situates moderates on the one hand against extremists on the other. And I think there's a continuity actually between sort of the British way of projecting power and influence in the world and the American way of doing it. And it's to do with the similarities in of how they operate as would-be liberal democratic societies, trying to exert force projection beyond their borders. Throughout its history, both in the British context and the American context, an effort has been made to locate the Brotherhood on this spectrum to decide, is it moderate or is it extremist? And indeed, whether there are moderate or extremist factions within the movement. And I call this kind of Kremlinology, borrowing the term from the Cold War days, kind of criminology at work that you see again and again when you look at kind of the diplomatic dispatches, the diplomatic and intelligence analysis that's being done, you know, trying to understand, is this person a hawk or a dove? Is this group of people are they conservatives? Are they reformists? I think this kind of recurs again and again and again. And as I say, this language of diplomacy is a fundamental feature of Anglo-American foreign policy making. It's at the heart of the effort to project power, secure their interests with minimum effort. Whether those interests are defined by empire, as was in the British case, or by the exigencies of Cold War, or the effort to promote democratization, as in the American case subsequently, time and again, the effort to locate, to identify, and in a sense anoint local allies and partners has been framed in this language. And I think that has important consequences then, because that language filters out into broader policy discourse, and we end up in a kind of confusion often about whether moderate versus extremist is a kind of value judgment, is it purely a kind of relativistic judgment in relation to a broader context, or is it something more essential about judging the nature of this group? In addition, the fact that this paradigm has been used, and has been used in order to try and identify moderates and extremists in relation to other interests, it means that the Western powers have always looked at the Brotherhood through the prism of other priorities, whether that be, as I've just said, imperial survival, the struggle against communism, concerns about Islamic fundamentalism, as the language the moment really had it, but as I said, push for democratization, or fears about groups like Al-Qaeda and sort of broad jihadist movement more latterly. Always the Brotherhood, mostly the Brotherhood has been approached through these other lenses, and that has an ugly distorting effect on how you view the movement. And certainly one of the consequences of this, I think it's actually something that Lorenzo first saw write very clearly about, is that there's been no sustained coherent policy towards the Brotherhood, as the Brotherhood really. Instead, as I say, it's also viewed via other issues. and always bracketed, therefore, with this language of extremist or moderate. And at the risk of simplifying my own argument, we can chart a shift from tendency in the early years, the first two, 3 decades, to always talk about the Brotherhood as extremist, or actually the preferred language of the British actually was fanatical. It's the language of fanaticism occurs again and again in the British documents. So in the first phase, of always the Brotherhood was seen as an inherently extremist, inherently fanatical organisation, down to, in recent decades, a preference for describing it as quote-unquote moderate. It's clear from looking at the documents that the 1970s are kind of the key hinge for this shift from seeing it always extremist to much more inclined to see it as moderate. And again, the context there is framed by broader Islamic, again, this, using the language of the documents, I should say, the language of Islamic fundamentalism. The Brotherhood is situated within this wider assertion of Islamic fundamentalism. And so it begins to look like something quite different, I think, to a lot of diplomats and observers. This is also the period of Anwar Sadat's alliance with the Brotherhood, and that too, I think, has an effect on how it is seen in many Western circles. This in itself, I'm not going to say too much about this, perhaps we can get into this more in questions, but I think this notion of kind of an evolution, if you want to put it that way, it presupposes also an evolution on the Brotherhood, in the Brotherhood's history, which I would say is kind of out of kilter with the group's own reading of its history. If you look at the way in which the Brotherhood frames its own history, its own trajectory, it sees itself as having passed through almost much more of a kind of cyclical process, that you have the original moment, if you like. You could say it's almost a kind of selfish reading of the Brotherhood's own history, really. It's kind of the original moment of purity defined by Al-Banna. That's not Al-Banna who creates the movement. Then arguably a kind of a moment of confusion and corruption that comes after the death of Al-Banna that lasts through the cyclical period. And then from the 70s, a return to the original meaning, the original kind of clarity. This is how the leaders of the Brotherhood kind of, I think, conceive of their movement, as a sort of return to original, trying to get back to kind of that original purity, sort of going back to the true message of Al-Banna. And Al-Banna remains the kind of the guiding light for the movement. So they don't have this notion really of kind of evolution from extremism to moderation that is at the core of many Western readings of the Brotherhood. And actually, again, a sort of sidebar point really, I think one of the striking things about the Brotherhood is the continuity, ideologically speaking, that the group demonstrates. And a remarkable stasis almost in sort of fidelity to Hassan al-Banna and his writings. And within that ideology, I would argue Occidentalism is absolutely central. I'll say more about that shortly. Before getting to that, however, the second major theme that the book, I think, demonstrates is that there have always been periods of Western engagement with the Brotherhood. And just to quickly chart these, really the first begins in the 1940s, 1940-1941, and in that context it's British military intelligence during the Second World War, engaging with the Brotherhood because they hope, they think it might be possible to buy it off, essentially, and to end what is seen as Brotherhood's aversion against the British position in Egypt. So 1940-1941 is, I think, the first moment of serious Western engagement, if you like, with the Brotherhood. Then between 1945 and 1948, you see a series of talks between Hassan al-Banna and other Brotherhood leaders and a number of British and American diplomats in this period that I think the Americans really begin to take notice of the Brotherhood, and I won't say much more on that because I think I'll perhaps say a bit more on that, but there's some really interesting stuff in the American archives about that. I spent days getting that little rickety shuttle bus out to College Park back in 2014 to kind of read these documents over and over, and it's some really sort of fascinating material there about the Brotherhood. That sort of period of engagement, when you see, as I say, Hassan al-Banna himself sitting down with kind of important local diplomats, that comes to an end with the suppression of the Brotherhood in 1948. Then, when the Brotherhood revives in the early 1950s, between 1951 and 1954, the period straddling the July 1952 coup and revolution of Nasser, again, the diplomats are talking regularly to the Brotherhood, and actually, again, senior Brotherhood leaders going out of their way to talk to the West, and this includes sending senior Brotherhood emissaries, if you like, to the West, including to the US, people like most famously Saeed Ramadan, comes to the US to sort of try and present a different world view. He's invited, well, sort of invited by the State Department. Actually, he very much pushes himself forward, interestingly. It's an issue covered in Ian Johnson's very good book, A Mosque in Munich, that I'd recommend, although I slightly disagree in the way that he frames that visit, but that's another story. Again, that episode of engagement was brought to an end by NASA's decisive repression of the Brotherhood at the end of 1954. Again, in the 1970s then, when the Brotherhood revives under Sadat, that I mentioned earlier, there's a revival of talks at various levels, including right up to the Murshid, the general guide of the Brotherhood. In that period, Omar Tomasani is engaging with the West. Stops around the period of Sadat's clampdown on the Brotherhood, and then again from the 1980s, really down to 2001, and some really interesting material here in the, kind of the WikiLeaks documents, various CIA classified documents showing occasional contacts with senior Brotherhood leaders. So the book really is sort of charting this story in detail, but that's a quick overview of these different episodes of engagement. So what do these episodes of engagement show? I would say, firstly, an effort to inform Western understandings of the Brotherhood on this paradigm of moderate versus extremism. That is continually what they come back to. That's, in a sense, from a Western perspective, a key goal of these talks, of this engagement. But also, crucially, at various points, a core strand of thinking is that the Brotherhood is biddable. This phrase sort of occurs. The hope that by engagement, you might be able to encourage the brothers to change their behavior. And in a sense to become, I think it'd be too strong to say an asset of Western power, but certainly that you can affect change in the way the Brotherhood operates, and that you can make them a more amenable force as regards Western power in Egypt and the region. And this was never dominant. I don't want to over-exaggerate this. Engagementism, if you like, was always a minority strand. But again, I think over history it becomes an increasingly larger minority of sort of opinion that looks at this, that comes to think that by engagement you can have a productive engagement, productive talks with the Brotherhood. And why this happens, I think, is that, again, what I said earlier, the 1970s are a key hinge. And I think one of the things that one also sees in this period is, from this period onwards, is what I describe in the book as kind of growing fatalism and pessimism about the Middle East more broadly, about societies like Egypt, and increasing numbers of policymakers and indeed members of the commentariat more generally come to the view that the societies like that of Egypt are A, inherently conservative and religious, and B, crucially, that the Brotherhood is the authentic manifestation of that conservatism. These two ideas grow in tandem, and that's a kind of crucial underpinning, I think, to this growing preference within a number of people, the number of people have for engagement. So there's increasingly a view, and it comes through in the documents of the 70s and the 80s, that essentially the Brotherhood is the future, and that rulers like Sadat and Mubarak are somehow inauthentic, that they are standing in the way of a tide that will at some point eventually sweep them away. And in that context, therefore, sort of logic runs, wouldn't it be the best idea to kind of get on side with groups like the Brotherhood and engage with them? Particularly the 80s, I would say that a key influence here is kind of a reading of what happens in the Iranian context in 1979. It's a sort of fear that the Americans didn't know who any of Khomeini and any of those people were, and that therefore wouldn't it be better to get in on the ground floor, as it were, and engage with groups like the Brotherhood in advance of the time when they ascend to power? So that's a kind of crucial input into this way of thinking. The third aspect I'll talk about is that really is then looking from the other side, and again, I should have said perhaps at the beginning, one of the things I try to do in the book is look at this question from both sides to understand both what Western policymakers have thought about the Brotherhood, but also understand in detail kind of what the Brotherhood thinks of as the West. And I think one of the things I learned is just how important the West has been, kind of even more than I sort of originally sort of imagined or guessed, to the Brotherhood, and how important engagement has been to the Brotherhood, both for pragmatic but also ideological reasons. the founder of the Brotherhood, Hassan Albano, I think at an intellectual but also tangible level, saw himself as in dialogue with Western power, and he understood that power to exist in a broad sense, politically, culturally, militarily, all bound up into the kind of Western civilization, which is, he saw it as a profoundly deleterious influence on the evolution of his own society. For Albano and for those in his movement who agreed with him, the West was the critical negative other against which they framed their own project, and without which I think the Brotherhood would not exist, essentially. The Brotherhood is born of this dialectical reading of Western power in places like Egypt and the wider region. The Brothers see their mission as being to counter the negative impact of Western power and the world order, in a sense, that the Western power has constructed. And this exists, this is the view in the 30s and 40s, where that world order is defined by imperialism, essentially, as much as it is in latter years when, in a sense, the Brotherhood imbibes the doctrine, or the language, the rhetoric, the new world order of 1990-1991, and sees that as a profoundly negative development. The Brothers have a deeply held perception, I would argue, of kind of the world of Islam as being an existential crisis, arising from the machinations of the quote-unquote enemies of Islam. This is a phrase that occurs repeatedly across Brotherhood literature, and really, I think, at its core, in a sense, the Brotherhood worldview is bounded by the sense of this underlying contest between the forces of Islam on the one hand, which sees itself as the foremost bearer, and, let's say, the enemies of Islam, which identifies primarily now with the West. This feeds a deep-seated narrative of victimhood, often through the history of the Brotherhood, and again, deeply conspiratorial worldview, often in how they read events that occur in the region and also more broadly. They blame the West, Western interference especially, for all kinds of kind of pernicious developments, and Palestine is kind of, one has to mention this, is a kind of absolutely sort of critical element to it. The kind of conflict between the Israelis and the Palestinians, the creation of the Israeli state in the first place for the Brotherhood, is a kind of an original sin of the West, in their view, from which there is, it's hard to see how, in their view, that is resolved, really. It's described by some Brotherhood leaders as a kind of fundamental obstacle, in their view, to good relations with the West. So this is a kind of critical example, I think, of this conspiratorial perception, reading of the world. And essentially, the Brotherhood is convinced that the West understood in a kind of abstract sense as a sort of world historical force is against it. Now, the irony of that is that despite that view, the Brotherhood has embraced a kind of pragmatic political posture regularly and has sought an accommodationist approach with various actual Western powers repeatedly, as I sort of mentioned earlier. Partly because it's so convinced, I think, of the power of its enemies as kind of slightly contorted but plausible ideological logic behind that. If you believe the West is so powerful and this kind of almost diabolical threat, then you should try and head off that threat, head off this kind of imagined and at times, I should say, real onslaught against the Brotherhood from enemies both at home and abroad. The Brotherhood has also benefited from the willingness of successive local governments and Western diplomats partners to accommodate it. And again, if you go back to the 1930s and 1940s, various royal governments, the palace governments of Ali Maha, the Nationalist Party of the WAFT, other royalist governments like Dr. Mahmoud Al-Qarashi, Ismail Sidki, then the years of Nasser, Sadat, Mubarak, externally the Jordanians, the Saudis. At various points, all of these groups, all of these individuals, have been willing to work with the grain of the Brotherhood and to accommodate it. And this diverse cast of characters, the fact that all of them at one point or another have sought to work with the Brotherhood, I think shows that the Brotherhood has a kind of chameleon-like political quality. It was a friend of the palace in Egypt in the 1930s when it believed this offered an avenue for advance. It then backed the overthrow of the monarchy in the early 1950s when it recognised the military strength and the potential benefit of working with the new Nasserist dispensation. So the Brotherhood has made a virtue of political deep political pragmatism that comes along with this powerfully held ideological view of the world. And to the West, too, the Brotherhood has sought to be often whatever its interlocutors wished it to be. So in the 1940s, in those moments of engagement with the British and the Americans in the 1940s, Hasna Brother constantly underlined his anti-communist credentials and the fact that the Brotherhood was the best bulwark against the spread of socialism instead of communism across the Middle East. In the 1960s, when Nasser had very much fallen out of favour with the Western powers, then it emphasised its anti-Nasserism. More recently, it's emphasised its democratic credentials and its anti-jihadist credentials, if you like, and continuously emphasised that it forms the best obstacle, the best barrier to groups like Al-Qaeda and more recently ISIS. So throughout, the Brotherhood has, like any party, the Brotherhood in adopting its sort of pragmatic political politics is, like many other political parties, you know, it's acting according to its own interests, but alongside this, this closely held ideological meaning of the world. Okay, so you're pleased to know I'm going to try and wrap this up. Just to some conclusions, and then I'll have you pick up on any points in kind of Q&A. One thing I would say is that many of those who've worked with the Brotherhood, that sort of list of people, both home and abroad, that I mentioned just now, have come to regret it. There has been a feeling in which, and you could extend this point arguably to include kind of the liberal revolutionaries after 2011, there has been a sense that engagement with the Brotherhood has not delivered on what many of those in favour of it hoped. And I would argue Western diplomats, Western commentators, have perhaps not engaged with that reality enough. There's been precious little analysis of the merits and demerits of engagement in and of itself. Instead, that the sort of the reflex for engagementism, again to use that phrase, and neologism, has remained a very powerful one. Despite the fact, I would say it's very legitimate to ask what has engagement with the Brotherhood achieved, and what can it realistically achieve in the future? What are the parameters of engagement? It has been actually, I think, a very under-conceptualised process when one looks at it historically. So it has been this reflex to which people have returned, but there's been very little serious thinking about what engagement from a Western perspective is meant to achieve, or indeed what the Brotherhood is trying to achieve from its perspective. By talking and having dialogue with the West. There's been arguably not enough, I think, serious critical reflection on the politics of the possible on this issue. That being said, why has it, and I'll sort of conclude with this, you know, why has this reflex for engagement existed? Well, to go back to where I started, there hasn't been, I think, any grand conspiracy to align the Brotherhood to the West or to put the West in power, whether in the 70s, the 80s, the 90s, or more recently, that there just isn't, again, it's probably because there just hasn't been that kind of level of strategic thinking about these issues, I think. There is no grand conspiracy to empower the Brotherhood. But as I said earlier, what I think we have seen is a growing perception, particularly since the 80s, that the Brotherhood was the coming force in the region, that it spoke to an inherently conservative essence within Muslim societies, and that therefore it was better to accommodate it kind of fatalistic reasons, on the belief that their victory will be inevitable. So kind of this fatalism, I think, mixed with the perception, increasingly, that if not the Brotherhood, then surely someone far worse, has driven in more recent years this preference for engagement. And I think that sort of way of thinking about this issue provides a critical backdrop for understanding then what happens after 2011, some of the steps that are taken by the Obama administration in 2011. So I'll call it to halt there. And
great. Thank you, Martin. A very comprehensive overview. I think you did justice to the monumental work that you did, and it was very comprehensive.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It's a fascinating study. I haven't read the book, but I will love it, I'm sure. And while you were talking, in my mind, you know, I had images and archives and ideas and interviews myself, you know, related to these topics. So once again, I really look forward to going in depth here with your book. So I'm looking for fascinating discussions. Actually, two or three things very briefly. The idea of the Muslim Brotherhood, and by the way, we should maybe focus on one thing to start with. I'm talking from a US point of view, I'm not working on the British point of view. So my work here in DC is dedicated to the study of the US engagement, the US, how the US has been interacting with the brothers for almost one century. Actually, first of all, we talk about brothers, Muslim Brotherhood, or Ikhwan Muslimin, or Muslim Brotherhood. The word Islamism, the concept of political Islam, never appears. It appeared, I mean, 80s, 90s, maybe, you prefer? Yeah. So for decades, we have something dedicated to Islamism as a national issue. Islamism as a national issue, I mean, it's first of all, they are called fanatical, they are called extremists, possibly violence. The first mention, as you know, to the Muslim Brotherhood in the US State Department's archives, when you tell the shuttle when they go to college for an MBA, it's 1944. So it's quite interesting because the movement was founded, as we know, in 1927 or 28. So for years, actually, for quite a significant period of time, the Brotherhood is not the radar. And then what makes an ideology, what makes a movement noticeable? Is it about being violent, possibly violent? Is it being so popular? Is it about being a potential ally, especially when you don't buy their initial ideology, when it comes to the Brotherhood ideology, creating a caliphate, unifying the Muslim worldwide, and so on and so forth. So I completely agree with you. And this idea, that's the first, they say, the global pattern. Then the second set of questions is, how do we deal with somebody that you don't like? That's the question, because you can use concept, but the idea is how you socialize with people that with whom you have a certain, with whom you don't share a common ground. Especially, you know, because that's why I completely agree with you, you have to historicize, you know, for example, the idea before the Cold War, during World War II, was, are they useful against the Nazis or the Germans in the Middle East and their allies? Then, over the Cold War, are they useful against the communists? We don't like them, and they don't like the communists either, so maybe the enemy of my enemy can be my friend, you know, the famous, very famous principle. Then, the 80s, when they start, 70s, late 70s and early 80s, when they start becoming violent with the Islamic groups in Ghana, Islamia, should we fear them? Then 1991, very important momentum, a very dividing day, because we have this idea that well, we no longer have a Soviet adversary or an enemy. So perhaps, you know, in that one, for example, you have mentioned Bernard Lewis, I mean, the idea of having the East, the Islamic East, as a potential or possible challenge or a possible enemy is a key question from this moment onwards. And then the crisis of the Arab regimes and the rise of the Brotherhood as a popular and social movement, strong social movement, that could, you know, politically speaking, become a major player, you know, at the head of some states. So, and then the Arab crisis, or the Arab Spring. And I think with you, I mean, this periodization of how you identify some key periods, that's exactly what we find out when we have a look at the archives. Then comes the idea of how do we deal with that? And you have this idea of, you know, this paradigm of moderating against extremists, and extremists are going to be on just 2 minutes. And actually, it's still a dividing point, because we have these people, for example, on the one hand, I give you one very striking example. You have said, which is fascinating to me, that to some people, at the highest level of the US leadership, the idea that, okay, maybe we don't like them, but they are an authentic movement. That's exactly what Dennis Ross told me in an interview, you know, famous diplomat. And, he said, basically, when the Arab crisis in Egypt, Tunisia, first of all, then Egypt happened, you know, we had at the top of the, at the head of the US leadership, we had two things, two sides. People say we have our national interests, and deeply embodied sense of the Muslim Brothers, they contradict our national interest, which is oil, of course, energy, the Gulf security, Israel having stability, the famous so-called stability. And you know, by the sense, in terms of ideology, the Muslim Brothers, they contradict our US international interest. We cannot trust them. And he told me, we lost the party, we lost the game, because, I mean, the other side won. Which means that international, when you are studying international relations, values, whether you like it or not, or we like it or not, I mean, they do value for it, they do have importance. Like him, he told me that we had another generation of diplomats and counselors saying, okay, maybe we don't like them, but we should be on the right side of history. In the name of, on behalf of the same national interest. Because, I mean, if tomorrow they win, what are we going to do? if we have a Muslim brother leadership or a Muslim brother who's friendly or oriented leadership, are we going to say we don't like them and we, okay, that's it? Or are we going to fight, or do we need to fight in the name of, on behalf of this very, very, I mean, this famous engagement policy? You use the word engagementism or like it. I mean, yeah, so this idea of how do we do, and when I talk about this, I'm just publishing, you know, how you do, I mean, verbally speaking, in terms of verbal inciting when it comes to dealing with people you don't like, I would be happy to have your opinion for further discussion. So, I mean, this question of they are authentic at the end of the day, I think that's the end of my comments here. Perhaps that's a question since the coup and the idea that the society could contract the Muslim Brotherhood. I mean, I'm not focusing on the conspiracy theory because, I mean, I agree with you, there is no real, I mean, when you study that topic, there are power struggles, there are, I mean, representations and narratives and whatever, but you don't have this sort of, long-term conspiracy. You have momentums or periods of engagement, periods of, you are more skeptical and so on. So perhaps, since 2013, I mean, onwards, or today, for example, at the Egyptian level, at the grassroots level, the rappers are much more popular than 2 or 3 years ago, again, because of the Sisi, the Sisi regime policy. Perhaps we have a new trend, I don't know, that would be my final question, a new trend in how the Muslim Brotherhood have been perceived, and they are still perceived, at least in, from my point of view, at the US level, and at to the British level. So this idea that maybe the society, Arab societies, and disregard the Egyptian society is much more complex, and for good, we have this idea that societies and states are quite different, and we should deal with the realities. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mahalik. Let me just add in a couple of comments. I think both of you touched on the part of the analysis of the Brotherhood that is most common, which is the foreign policy aspect of it, the Brotherhood in the Middle East. And obviously, we focused a lot on Egypt, and I think we could have talked about different countries. There are brotherhoods, obviously, different countries, and what the analysis is in the State Department, whether we treat them as one giant movement, or, of course, we differentiate because the Brotherhood in Jordan is completely different from the Brotherhood in Yemen, the Brotherhood in Algeria, and so on and so forth, and how long it takes historically, that's sort of a question that I have for the Arabists here, to develop a consciousness, because there's different movements in different countries and have different different takes on what is the core ideology of the Brotherhood and have different approaches to politics, some more pragmatic, some less. That part I'll leave it to you. What I'm going to talk about very briefly is a very similar, I would say symmetric, parallel debate that has taken place for the last 20 years in Western countries about the Brotherhood in the West. The history is fairly well documented, although at the time still a bit contested, about the fact that the Brotherhood started basically in the end of the 1950s, early 60s. You mentioned Sayyid Ramadan, the father of Tariq Ramadan. Some of the first pioneers came to the West. Again, I think you have in some cases a very conspiratorial take on how the first brothers came to the West. It wasn't really a conspiracy to take over the West. It was mostly a few individuals like Sayyid Ramadan who had to escape Egypt or Syria or other countries where they were persecuted. And from a quantitative point of view, the majority of individuals were actually students who came. You know, that's a typical profile of Brotherhood members, highly educated, upper middle class, and they came to some of the universities of the United States, quite a bit, and of many European countries to study, mostly engineer, medicine, technical disciplines for the most part. They started some of the very first structures, some of the Muslim organizations in the West. They replicated the Usra system, the system of meetings, of very well structured, very hierarchical, very formalized structure that the Brotherhood retains in the Middle East. They replicated it, obviously, on a much smaller scale in a Western setting, and they started some of the first organizations, Muslim organizations in the West that we're talking about, depending on what country we're focusing on, 1960s, 1970s. Now, over time, there's been an evolution of these organizations. You still have, I mean, that's a very contested part, you still have that secret part. And there's a lot of debate within Brotherhood circles about why that part of the Brotherhood presence in the West is kept secret. A little pitch for myself. I'm working on a book, and both of you have been helping me in different ways, on the Brotherhood in the West, and I'm interviewing many people who have left the Brotherhood, who have left the movement, and we're talking about a couple of dozens of individuals in different continents, and all of them are saying one of the things that they that led them to leave the movement was the secrecy that existed in the West, which, while justified in the Middle East, it's unjustified in a democratic open society in the West. The fact that there is a structure that membership is kept secret is a completely reasonable thing in a country like Syria, a country like Egypt, for obvious reasons. It is less justified in a Western setting, and it might be sort of a cultural heritage for those of the first generation, those who arrived in Syria from Egypt in the 60s and 70s. I understand why, if you arrive in the West, you're not immediately going to shed your secrecy. But after 40, 50 years of presence in the West, that's a criticism that a lot of people within the Brotherhood leverage against the leadership. The movement should be not as secretive, particularly now that it's mostly run by people of second generation, born and raised in the West. There shouldn't be that level of secrecy. But there's been an evolution of some of the organizations that that milieu created, those pioneers of the first generation that arrived here. A lot of the organizations they created have, to some degree, evolved from an ideological and from an organizational, from a structural point of view. I think even the most aggressive critic of the Brotherhood would recognize that flexibility and pragmatism are the name of the game when it comes to the Brotherhood. I think both of you highlighted it in different ways. And obviously they understood full well that what the priorities and what the goals of the movement in Muslim-majority countries were not applicable in countries where Muslims were a small minority. You're not going to turn Sweden or Spain or Canada into an Islamic state anytime soon. And if you might have some of the more rabid, sort of foaming at the mouth Islamists arguing that the Brotherhood is much more sophisticated than that. The goals have to some degree changed, and I think that's better. You get a lot of conspiracies on both sides, or simplistic analysis on both sides, let's put it like that, on what those goals are, how they have changed. And we get to a very similar analysis to what you had about foreign policy, is the never-ending debate about what the Brotherhood in the West is and whether they're part of the problem or part of the solution, whether they're the good guys or the bad guys, whether they are a force for good or they are problematic. And you see that that dynamic played out on different levels. There's the security ambit. There's the conversation taking place when it comes to integration. There's the foreign policy aspect of it. There's different layers that the conversation takes place. But the bottom line is that you're not going to find any single Western government that has reached what is even remotely a cohesive assessment on what the Brotherhood in the West is, what its goals are, how it operates, and what the policy should be. In my very short introduction in the beginning, I was mentioning the British review in 2014. With all its flaws and its implementation, and it's been criticized quite a bit, some of the criticism fair, some of it a bit less, there was an attempt by a Western government to really understand a very complex phenomenon, both domestically and abroad. The idea of the review was to have two teams, one that looked at the situation inside the UK, so what the Brotherhood, and more broadly, they really meant political Islam, the sort of non-violent manifestation. So in a British setting, that meant a lot of Jama'a Islami and other movements from the South Asian subcontinent. What the movement is about, what it wants, and what a cohesive policy should be, and the same applied to a foreign setting, the Middle East and South Asia. What the movement wants, what's the ideology, how it evolves, who are the players, and what a cohesive policy should be. I would say that's a very flawed attempt, yet the best one we've seen in any Western country to have that kind of coherent debate. You recognize the same patterns of conversation, of debate, that Martin and Muhammad highlighted, friends or foes, are they, I think the word you use is biddable. Can we sway them? Can we, and I think in a lot of European countries in particular, right, in the US as well, there's been that debate domestically as well. In a French setting, it would be what Sarkozy did around 2004, 2005, a big opening to UIF, which is a brotherhood organization in France, with the idea, and I think the way it was put by some French commentators is that they're going to become sort of the champagne socialists. They started off as very hardcore communists, and then we're communists, and then we're going to include them in the system, and they're going to become soft champagne socialists. But it's only through inclusion. If we shut them out of the debate, then they further radicalize. That's sort of the to some degree simplified, but that's sort of the idea that guided some of that approach in France back then, but it's, you can recognize a similar pattern in a lot of Western countries. In a UK setting, you had a very similar debate, and it was very much focused on security in that case. I think in France it was more about social control. One of the big debates there was, it wasn't really about terrorism, but it was the unrest in the banlieues. And the idea was the brothers are part of the solution. They are the ones that can help us keep parts of the Muslim community, the sort of part of the youth that's burning cars and so on. We can through the help of the brotherhood, we can enroll them to help us quell those dynamics. In the UK, it was very much, and we're talking about more or less the same time, 2005, 2006, a terrorism debate. It was the idea of the first incarnation of PREVENT, of the counter-extremism strategy in the UK, of basically we need, the language again was terrible on some level, we need moderate Islamists against radical Islamists. We will partner with, we will fund, that became obviously very controversial, we give financial support to organizations that are directly linked or at least trace their ideological roots to the Muslim Brotherhood, and in some cases also Salafi organizations, because they're non-violent. And it takes a radical to convince a radical, that was the argument. So we work with the Brotherhood to convince young people not to join Al-Qaeda and similar groups. And again, there's been endless debates in all countries in the West about what is the Brotherhood. I think in a way, that's the only part where I see the debate on foreign policy better, because it's clear who's Brotherhood and who's not. It's a fairly easy process to identify what organization is part of the Brotherhood or not. In the West, you don't even have that clarity, because you will have a lot of people who are part of the Brotherhood milieu, whether directly or not, deny that. That already creates a bit of a situation at times. But the debate is really then on engagement. Do you work with, do you partner with, do you partner with only on a tactical level, you make it a deeper strategic partnership, or you shut them out, they're the devil and you don't even talk to them. Those are the two sort of extremes, and it's been done in a very schizophrenic way in many Western countries, with at times same entities, same actors, same agencies taking completely different positions at the same time. I can think of some European governments which were literally in the same week, that's an American example too, prosecuting a certain organization linked to the Brotherhood for terrorism financing on the very same week, giving them funds to carry out some activities in favor of integration. So the devil or good guys we work with. I think it takes a lot of research and a lot of study of these organizations away from the heated political debates that often accompany this kind of debate. First of all, understanding really one of the most complex movements you can imagine, one that has different souls, one that is not always transparent, one that is it takes different forms and adopts different tactics in different parts of the world and at different times. And we're really still at this stage, I think Martin's book shows that it's difficult to have a policy, whether of engagement or not engagement, if you don't have a good assessment, if you don't understand who you are dealing with. And if you don't know in some cases some of the basic facts of who your interlocutors are, who you're trying to engage. So I think the effort obviously on Martin's part with this monumental book, as I said many times, is very, very helpful. I also hope that the events we organize here try to sort of provide that that background. And I think this is the time for that thoughtful conversation with you. And if you have any questions, I mean, this is the time to have it. Okay, do we have mics going around? So, yeah. No, we're very improvised today. If you could just say, because I know you're Cameron, but if you can identify yourself and ask a question.
Yeah, I'm Cameron Bukhari, Center for Global Policy. One question for each of you. Martin, I was intrigued by your comment about maintaining a pragmatic outlook, if I'm paraphrasing correctly, while adhering to ideological purity. Given that political learning happens at all levels amongst all types of actors, how do you see that dynamic playing out? Could you tease that a bit out more? I hope you can offer a response. And Mohammed, when the Brotherhood was in power in Egypt in 2012, it faced the first crisis with the war in Gaza against Hamas. And I came across some very odd statements from the leadership of the Brotherhood, actually not very sympathetic to Hamas, and saying something to the effect that you've created a problem for us, you know, a few months into power. So given your work on Islamist foreign policy, how did the Brotherhood, or did the Brotherhood play a role of any significant proportions during that crisis?
It's a very good question. And I think part of this, thinking about this part of it, actually, I almost kind of favor the way we use words, often I think put these, those two words you mentioned, you're also sort of often put on a spectrum that we talk about groups that are either in very ideological or deeply pragmatic, but actually, if we're talking about what pragmatism means, it's just your ability to kind of weigh up resources and the means as, and their ability to achieve ends. So being intensely, having this very strong and clear ideological worldview doesn't in any way stop you from being pragmatic. And actually, in terms of the history of the Brotherhood, because within that worldview you have, as I say, this Occidentalist vision in which the West is kind of so central, but also a kind of strong emphasis on the importance of the Tanzim and the organization, and because the Brotherhood believes it has this unique mission to play, the Brotherhood's achieving its goals, kind of a key way to achieve its goals is to always secure and develop the strength of its own organization. And so for the sake of the organization, actually, you can end up through kind of that working logic being able to justify what appear on the surface actually to be, you know, ideological somersaults, but I would argue are legitimated within sort of Brotherhood thinking by the belief that the sort of the ends justify the means, that the higher purpose that they're working towards allows this actually more pragmatic than a modus operandi, because survival is everything, because the greatest disaster, or the next greatest disaster that could befall the owner would be the destruction of the Brotherhood itself. So the Brotherhood has made time and again this virtue of being very pragmatic. I mean, the question kind of, how much do they learn? I mean, actually, this was, I was thinking while Lorenzo was talking, perhaps I'm going to throw a question over to him, because I mean, one of the interesting things to me, I look at it bit in the chapters in the book, the later chapters in the book, is what happens then when you do have these Brotherhood movements that emerge in the West, in a sense therefore are necessarily exposed to the greater complexity of Western society, that whereas in traditional Brotherhood thinking, the West is very much this abstract monolith, that you do have, the very fact of being in the US or being in Britain kind of forces certain Brotherhood leaders and individuals to kind of confront that. It was a question I sort of never really resolved, I think, in the book, was, how much ideological influence does that have, sort of rebounding back on the movement, how much space is there for ideological revisionism affected by Brotherhood groups in the West, for that kind of process of learning. I think my sort of tentative conclusions were, I didn't see much evidence of it, but Lorenzo perhaps knows this, that does that terrain better than me, so I'll just pass that on to him, but I don't know if.
Not necessarily. I agree with you. Thank you for your question. When it comes to how the Egyptian authorities have dealt with the Gaza war, Gaza issue, Gaza assault, it's really, they have been put to the test they are identified, they are considered to be an Islamist movement, and Hamas is also an Islamist movement. So how do you deal with your alter ego first? But it have also been put to the test as a state-building political force, as a product of the revolutionary process, you know, the famous Arab Uprising 2012. So the idea is that you're right when you're saying that people, I mean, of course, in terms of philosophical, religious solidarity, they were completely siding with, at the Muslim Brotherhood leadership level and at the grassroots level, they completely embraced the Palestinian cause. It's not me. They are Islamists, and they are Egyptians, and they are Egyptians, and they are Arabs. So, I mean, there is no surprise. But the idea that the new feature came from the fact that they were a leading force at that time, institutionalized through the revolutionary process, or because or out of the revolutionary process. So as far as I know, and according to the interviews and so on, there was a sort of duality, because of course they were siding with Hamas, blaming Israel for killing Palestinians, war crimes, killing Muslims, killing neighboring people in Gaza and the Palestinians. But what I'm saying, you are right, is because that some of the Muslim brothers, some of the leaders, they had the feeling that they were pressurized because of the war, because they had to take a clear stance. Are we political, responsible political leaders? Are we the true responsible leaders of Egypt? Or are we, first of all, Muslim brothers? Are we, to put it differently, are we, first of all, politically driven or ideologically driven or identity driven? Yes, I mean, you understand what I'm saying. So this idea of, that's why, it's not only about, at that time, remember, Nahda was in power too. And we had the visit of 2, 3, 4 leading people, Islamist leaders from Tunisia, from Egypt, and other countries, mainly Tunisia and Egypt, going to Gaza and saying we will not accept more people killed here in the Gaza Strip. So Israel has to put an end to its war crimes, to its military operations. But at the same time, there were pressures on Hamas to accept, for example, curfew, to accept, you know, the end of hostilities. And by saying something which is more or less simple, we are going to support you, but first of all, you need to stop. And that allowed the Egyptian Muslim Brothers, you know, to appear, to be seen as responsible on the one hand and as being in total solidarity with the Palestinian people on the other hand. It's a very complex issue, Gaza, actually. But it was actually completely, what I can say, that they were put to the test, you know, in these two regards. Did I answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
I'm not dodging your answer, but I want to see if there are other questions. Please.
Hi, Mohamed Yunus from Gallup. I had a question, really just for the panel, if anyone wants to take it. This idea, we've been talking about this idea of the ideological piece and the pragmatism piece of the Muslim Brotherhood and engagement. And one thing I noticed, just kind of close to what was happening in Egypt, is a lot of people sort of assumed that the ideological piece for them was supreme. These people believe in a cause, they believe in an ideology, a faith, they're non-corrupt, they're non-corruptible. And I think what a lot of people discover is actually the pragmatism is what drives the organization. And ideology is really just a rallying call. So a lot of people, even in this town, that were very much vocal about engaging Muslim Brotherhood after the coup, the overthrow of Morsi, they sort of took hook, line, and sinker into this, they believe in democracy, they're the elected government, whereas if you were really following what the Muslim Brotherhood was doing and saying, in the lead up to that, it was pretty clear that a lot of that was the pragmatism of using the language of the moment, really, to co-opt power. So what can you tell us about what you've seen in engagement sort of models of the Brotherhood, and to what degree people who see them more as a pragmatic organization versus seeing them more as an ideological organization can sort of influence the effectiveness of that engagement?
So I'll offer some thoughts. I think it's just a mistake to operate on this binary of putting these two things opposite. I mean, I just think it's very interesting. Just go back to my original sort of background. You know, I my PhD and my initial research work was on the Irish Republican movement, Sinn Féin. It's thing that draws me to it is you have the same debate there, which is this a movement driven by ideology or is it a movement driven by kind of political opportunism? I mean, ultimately, these are movements that seek power, right? They're interested,
these two names for them are not hard to it's not hard to put them together in their mind, that they believe themselves to be acting with an ideological consistency, and they're, without wanting to kind of get too sort of Foucauldian into it all, you know, their structure of the discourse, the way they use their discourse, is their reading of a certain kind of ideological purity. So they view themselves, they view their actions as ideologically consistent, and they also believe that by attaining power and trying to obtain power in society and indeed in terms of accessing higher reaches of office, that that will further the ideological goals that they seek to achieve. So for them, those two, there isn't that dichotomy. Political actors around the world can hold all kinds of what to us might seem strangely incongruent ideas simultaneously in their head and see a consistency there that arguably you might think isn't there. So I think, yeah,
thank you very much. Actually, very quickly, because your question raised a very interesting point in my mind. The fact is, when you look at the archives, for example, the forces, when it comes to how the US has interacted or to some extent with the robbers, you have in the very first reports already made that the robbers, they are fanatical, not only British term, also US term, very violent. So it's very, by the way, it's very interesting because ultimately the US vision was driven by what? Fear of violence, values, identity, and the capacity of mobilizing, the capacity of mobilization at the grassroots level. These three, four, the features are still today noticeable. For example, if you are aware of what happened, you know, in 2011, at that time, you know, when the revolution had meaning in Egypt, if you understand what I mean, you had this idea, first of all, commitment, the US leadership, you need to commit yourself to nonviolent strategy, first of all. That's the first one. Second one, I mean, you need to commit yourself to a free and democratic political process. Third was no violation, nothing, I mean, no harm when it comes to minorities' rights, like maybe, first of all, Christians and women in Egypt. And three plus one, the fourth one, is connected to what you said, it's about you need to respect and to stay in the limits of the peace treaty, Camp David peace treaty. So aside from Israel in the 40s, I mean, you have the three main, I mean, you can find it in the 40s. And then in the 50s, while the robbers were coming close to power, you know, the 54, the coup in 54, you had robbers who were members of the government. In the reports made by the same embassy in Cairo, you had the word that, well, they are orthodox. Well, they may be moderate. Well, if we can manage, if we know how to do, we can find a certain common ground with the robbers. For example, Hassan al-Budini, well, we had visits of the ambassador, you know, and the name was Daphne, it's very funny because, I mean, the Chargé d'Affaires and the embassy, the Daphne, I don't know if they are family of diplomats, but well, you have this idea that we can ultimately deal with them. So as you are going, I mean, getting close to power, the vision that the US had at that time, you know, when it came to the robbers, was shifting a bit. So it's not only about your ideology, it's actually a matter of context, it's a matter of representation, it's a matter of, you know, momentum. So how, for example, the brothers were seen at that time, and I don't know, I mean, if you have your opinion, so, but it's also a matter of, well, but now we have a very, what context do you take into account in order, you know, to get a certain vision of these movements? That's why the idea of pragmatism versus ideology is a matter of what the Muslim Brotherhood is, so a matter of assessment, as Lorenzo highlighted, but also a matter of, you know, but now what is, I mean, how do we have to face, first of all, the communists at that time? Because final point, you had absolutely no reports made in terms of direct connection between the ambassador, the US ambassador in Cairo, and the state secretary mentioned in the brothers in the 50s and the 60s, until 59. Once again, Islamism or Muslim Brotherhood was a national issue. It was never seen as a global threat. It became, I mean, to be a global threat as, I mean, in the 80s and 90s. So the same ideology has generated different visions because of different.
Yeah, Abdel Mawgudder Daily Center for Egyptian American Dialogue. This conversation is very important, and I really agree with the concept of engaging the Muslim Brotherhood rather than condemning it. I don't think condemning will help anyone. Will not help them. Will not help any of us here in the West, as you call it. Concerning the moment in which the Brotherhood was an important question about what is the future of culture in Asia. The debate was very powerful debate. And I think the book of Lord Cromer about modern Egypt is very crucial in this, in creating also that debate, especially his statement about creating an educational system to de-Muslimize Muslims. It was not really an enmity with the West. You know, Egypt was colonized, was occupied by the British. What did you expect the Egyptians to do? And I would like to think, as you stated in your book, of Hassan al-Banna, not as the beginning of something, but as a continuous process from Afghani to Abdu to Rashid Rida and to Banna. And I would like also hope that you pay more attention to the Muslim Brotherhood moving from an organization to becoming a school, rather than limiting itself to its own members, but opening up to the Muslim Ummah to welcome other intellectual input and it is the discussion now in the Muslim circles is about the school of the Muslim Brotherhood rather than the organization of the Muslim Brotherhood. From a historical perspective, at the beginning of your book, you stated something about, although you did not really focus on it in your book, about what happened after January 25th, the Egyptian Revolution, or the Arab Spring. But I sense that there is a problem in the West in relationship to democracy in Egypt and in the Arab world. I sensed as if there is a preference in the West, again, I take the West as you defined it, London and Washington, there is a preference of dictatorship rather than democracy in Egypt or the Arab world in the Muslim world. And usually with Muslim Democrats, I get this question a lot. How can Muslim Democrats or Arab Democrats or Egyptian Democrats help the West to get rid of this superiority complex and consider Arab Democrats, Muslim Democrats, as democracies, as legitimate democracies, rather than dealing with a dictatorship and prefer that dictatorship? So that is for Martin. For Mohammed and Lorenzo, I appreciate, although this engagement is very important, but I appreciate also it's very important to have those sympathetic with the Muslim Brotherhood to be part of this engagement, to be part of this dialogue, rather than being talked about. It's very important for them to be part of the conversation. Thank you.
So let me reflect on a couple of those points. I mean, you're right. I think the Brotherhood, at the moment of its origin, its creation, I describe it in the book as a particular form, if you like, of anti-imperialist politics. I mean, there's no denying that the context framed by English power, which is the phrase that they use a lot, the importance of England and sort of the cultural influence it's exercising over Egypt, the broader region, is a driving force. And so I think of the Brotherhood as a particular manifestation of anti-imperialist politics centered on a narrative of cultural authenticity, essentially. I guess my question, and I think I sort of, again, this is in a way the same question I was asking of the Lorenzo, which I think the book is slightly agnostic on, is, you know, how much evolution has there been ideologically within the Brotherhood, in a sense that I think, and I would tentatively suggest one way of reading sort of what happens to the Brotherhood after 2011 is actually, in a sense, the paucity of kind of political and ideological development and thinking within the Brotherhood. And I think even some sort of Muslim brothers, some of whom in exile, have sort of thought about this, that the problems the Brotherhood runs into is the absence, really, of any sort of developed program, the absence of a more modern, quote-unquote, kind of way of thinking about using power. Is the Brotherhood in some ways sort of trapped in this 1930s, 1940s time warp, partly through the nature of Egyptian society? I'm talking particularly about the Egyptian case here, but the strong control exerted by the military regime after 1952 means there just isn't the space for a lot of more open, free thinking, but the Brotherhood, among various other forces, suffers from that. And it means that when then you get to 2011, you could say that part of the problem is the Brotherhood is in many ways still sort of trapped in that 1930s, 1940s time warp and still talking about Hassan al-Banna and all this stuff that doesn't seem really that relevant. And so I think that's one of the issues that it faces, whether or not today it's any more likely to go through a process of serious ideological revisionism. I don't know, I sort of leave to others to reflect on. Also, the other part of your comment about, does the West prefer democracy or authoritarianism? I think in a way this is more a question about actually the limits of Western power in the region. At times we can overstate how much influence the West has on a country like Egypt, and that when it comes to whether Egypt was going to be emerge post-2011 as a vibrant democracy or slide back into authoritarianism, the key dynamics for all of that really lie within Egypt, I would argue, and the, really the ability of Western governments to influence it one way or another is actually fairly limited. And where it does have an impact is in the way in which Western policy is sort of seen and thought about. It's, it was going to occur to me while Lorenzo was speaking earlier that one of the skills of the Brotherhood over the years, again, this goes back to current pragmatic politics, one of the skills of the Brotherhood over the last however many decades is its ability to leverage engagement, which in many ways has been quite limited, but to leverage that where it can for its own benefit. And that we shouldn't dismiss that in a way, that images matter, language matters. So at one level you could say US engagement with the Brotherhood after 2011, the meetings that take place, they're quite limited, they're quite, there's no sort of mass embrace of the Brotherhood, no, in one sense, but actually what the Brotherhood does very effectively is to exploit those images of sitting with Ann Patterson or with John Kerry or whoever. It uses it very effectively to sort of underline the fact that it is the coming force. It creates the narrative that it wants people to believe, and so that is, I don't think we should overstate Western power, but I think we should also understand that what the West does and says has an impact and has an influence on these societies. So I don't know if that responds to
Thank you very much. Again, that's a very, very serious issue. But does the West, what is the West? So, does the West like Islamists? I mean, we have this idea of Arab Spring, Islamist winter, when it came to should we be happy when it comes to the Arab Spring? Should we be satisfied? You know, get satisfied with seeing people with whom we have strong ideological, disagreements, coming to power? Well, the question is, I'm not sure that ideologically we'll find a majority of people liking the Islamist agenda. But what is the Islamist agenda, by the way? That's if you have the hours, we can discuss that, but we don't have it. But you have this idea of ultimately, what can we expect of them once in power? That was the key question. It's not about, okay, we don't like them, okay, we have strong disagreements, okay, they may not like, as Martin said, they have this idea of the West as responsible for, the guilty, not responsible for what happened to the Islamic world. But ultimately, it was framed politically. For example, if you take, if you consider the US position or the French position, the case of Alain Juppé. At that time, he was the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in France, and he went to Tahrir Square, and he wanted to, I want to meet the young brothers. Maybe you know about this, his story. Okay, tell me about, your aspirations. We can talk to you. Let's say we have this new beginning policy, this reset policy. It was more or less the same, to some extent, at the US level, saying, okay, I can have many quotations if you are interested. Hillary Clinton saying, okay, we are open to discussing with all the players in the Egyptian political landscape, including the Muslim Brothers. So, all the US policy at that time was progressively opening, and of course trying to, establishing constraints. We are discussing with you, we open the door, we are okay discussing with you, as long as you do A, B, C, and D. Women, democracy, nonviolence, and so on and so forth. So it's a sort of, I'm not saying bargaining, but it's a sort of classical political configuration. You have to find a common field or a common ground with somebody that you, about whom you are skeptical. So is it about liking or not liking dictatorships? It's ultimately, what can you get? What can you have in terms of outcome? What can you get of this new political configurations? And as long as Morsi, for example, and the brothers, they get the impression that they could deal with the U.S. interest in the region, well, I mean, politics is politics. So, I mean, we could deal ultimately. And Ann Patterson, for example, she has very famous sentences. I can, for example, this one, I'm still uncomfortable when it comes to women's rights, but they were responsible when it comes to economic and diplomatic issues. So is it about liking them or unliking them? It's about, I mean, are they happy? Are we? Can we expect, you know, a good outcome of Morsi's presidency? So, and then ideologically, of course, now it's a matter of we don't like them, but we can politically deal with people, I mean, as long as they meet our expectations.
We have less than 5 minutes. I've seen a few hands. So why don't we get all the questions together? And but I'll re-urge you to be very, very quick in your one, two, and then three, and then wrap it up there. Please.
My name is Timur Aldadiri. I work with the Netherlands embassy. I think this last exchange was yes, an interesting and pertinent question. I think we do have experience also in engaging with more Islamist type governments. I think we should also look a little bit broader than the region. And in that sense, I was wondering if the Muslim Brotherhood, to what degree did they have an internal discussion about other examples? For instance, Indonesia, which also experienced a transition much earlier, where Islamist parties also had various strategies in reinventing themselves as legitimate players in the democracy. So I'm very curious to know how far that was used for discussions internally, and of course also thinking of Tunisia. And how far has that internal soul searching taken place?
Thank you for your presentations. I wanted to ask a comment.
Can you introduce yourself?
My name is Valerie Greenfeld. I'm a consultant for counterterrorism out of Jerusalem. And I wanted to ask, and my son is in the IDF at the border right now of Gaza and Israel, defending Israel and the IDF. And I wondered if you could please clarify your comments about Gaza and with regard to Israel, because my understanding is that a lot of Palestinians were actually brought into Gaza because of the Nakba and because of the March of Return, and I'm trying to figure out from your perspective how does the Muslim Brotherhood fit in with the scenario between the Palestinians and Hamas on the border there.
My name is Mahmoud Farouk, and I'm Egyptian, and I'm studying here in Syracuse Law School. I have two small questions. The first one about the future of the Muslim Brotherhood. Many people say that it's, the Muslim Brotherhood have faced several similar situations as the one that they face at the moment, especially in Egypt. If you compare this with what happened under Abdel Nasser, I don't know what is your comment about that, especially if we keep in mind that Abdel Nasser, I don't know, hanged a few of the Muslim Brotherhood in Sisi, killed almost 1,000 in one day in the streets. Also, you have the other Arab countries where they used to have a main, the Muslim Brotherhood used to have a main source of income coming to the organization from the Gulf countries, and those Arab Gulf countries are now taking side from the Muslim Brotherhood.
Sorry, I hate to urge you, but the bell was supposed to pass. And
the last one about the democratic Muslim groups. How do you see the Turkish example, where you have a Muslim Brotherhood or a party that comes from political Islam and now turned to be a player of others? So how do you see that?
Okay. Good. Very briefly, both of you. Sorry.
It's okay. And the question of internal soul searching. I mean, in a sense, that's again the question I've been asking. And you know, how serious have the Brotherhood been historically, and how serious are they now about reform and change and reappraisal? I think that is an open question. There's an interesting thing here as well about, you know, how serious are they? How deep does that reassessment go? So I mean, mentioned a couple of times, people mentioned the Tunisian example and Nafta and Ghannouchi. Now, that's interesting to me because, you know, Ghannouchi is someone who, in a lot of Western commentary, people have described him as a kind of Islamist democrat akin to kind of Christian democracy, Christian democrats. And yet, as far as I'm aware, I've looked at various things by Nahda, and I've never seen them talking about that analogy. I've never seen them say, you know, what would it mean for us to follow the path of Christian democracy, to follow the path of Muslim democracy. So, again, the question is left open. It's kind of not for me to answer, it's for them to answer. How serious are they about that kind of reform? I'll say something about the future of the Brotherhood. I think it is in an existential crisis, much bigger than the past, actually. And it's, if you look at Egypt in the last 4 or 5 years, you look at the Brotherhood in the last 4 or 5 years, it's witnessed probably the most serious internal ruption within the Brotherhood that has, you know, has been observable to outsiders probably in its history. There's been this split between the sort of historic leadership, most of whom are in exile, and a kind of new guard of leaders on the ground in Egypt who have been dissatisfied both with the Brotherhood's performance and power while they were in power, and on what they see as the limits of the Brotherhood's resistance to Sisi. And so there's been, you know, quite a kind of vociferous internal debate. Some people talk about a more formal split, these two leadership sort of poles in existence. Whether or not all that can be put back together, so far, you know, the efforts of people like Yusuf al-Qaradawi on the outside to kind of oversee a reconciliation process doesn't seem to have worked. And I think the challenge it faces is a very profound one. It's actually, you know, it sounds like I'm always answering questions with questions, but it's something that Mohammed said earlier. He mentioned that the Brotherhood was more popular again at a grassroots level. I'd be interested to know kind of why you think that. I mean, again, that's not it's not meant to be a leading question. It's just a quick question. I don't know if support within Egypt has returned to the Brotherhood. Such was the disillusionment with Morsi's period in power. I don't know how, in this generation, if you like, they can recover a sort of broader sympathy beyond their own membership. So those are just a couple of thoughts.
No, actually, you're right. I'm not saying that they are going to seize power again anytime soon. I'm saying that according to some polls, now today in 2016, 17, 18, they are more popular than 2013, 14. That's what I'm saying. I don't know if you confirm, but I mean, all the people that have been working, on Egypt now, Egyptian society, and it's related to your question, because I agree with you. Whatever you're saying, this has to do with a sort of existential threat. According to me, I agree with that, and specifically because of one factor. Because historically, we had a sort of vertical struggle. I mean, the brothers versus the regime. Nasser, Sadat, Mubarak, and whatsoever. Now we have two struggles. The vertical struggle between the brothers and, of course, people who don't like it. I mean, you have brothers in jail. I mean, you're a story, I don't have to elaborate on that. But you also have a sort of horizontal, I mean, today tension. Many people today within the Egyptian society do not like the brothers or do not trust them anymore. That's why I agree with you, actually. That's one of the key, maybe the issue for the brothers today. And it's connected to your point. It has huge impact for your question, because now you have, if you are a brother, of course, there is another question, what is a brother? Are we talking about leadership, are we the supporters, sympathizers, the young people, the old people? So you have this idea that, okay, I have a sort of Islamic feeling. How should I be defending my Islamic faith? Should I go to the Sinai? You know, for example, Khalid Hanani, for example, he has done work, you know, on how some brothers, you know, are joining some jihadist groups. You have some people that tend to be quite skeptical when it comes to political engagements, and they go for a more spiritual, spiritual understanding of the Islamic reference, for example. You have a set of different, reactions, you know, to this crisis. So this is, for me, an existential crisis. I'm not sure that the brothers are going to disappear anytime soon. When you are the brotherhood, you have a strong historical and social legacy, but the brothers in the next decades, at least in the next several years, will going to be extremely different from what we have seen. I mean, according to me, at least, I may be wrong, I mean, in the recent years, I don't know if you agree or not, but I mean, the brothers is going to go through huge, huge, huge changes, for me, at least. Madam, so you have said that I was answering a question about 2012. So now we don't have the brothers in the UB or ruling over Egypt. But your question is quite interesting, because we know I'm not inventing anything when I say that the brothers, the Muslim Brotherhood friendly movements, historically has played a huge role in the, what we call, whether we like the word or not, the Islamization of the Palestinian cause, the Palestinian struggle for independence or freedom. So Hamas did not come from, Hamas has a strong, I mean, social and popular, you know, supports. And Hamas was born in a Gaza Strip, not forget that, I mean, I'm going to go to the story. So this idea of having today an Islamic understanding, an Islamic framework of the Palestinian cause, it has to do with the Muslim Brotherhood action, the Muslim Brotherhood, I mean, policy for years or for the case. So today they are still a very, very important player in the Gaza Strip, not only in the Gaza Strip, but in the Gaza Strip. You have also the jihadists, they are rising. They have been rising over the last few years, several years. So today we have, I mean, a sort of very diverse, I mean, ideological and Islamist, landscape when it comes to Palestine. Not only Palestine, but Palestine is quite interesting because Hamas has more or less, to some extent, played the same game, trying to go for institutional politics, running for elections, seizing power. There was, of course, as you know, what happened in 2006 and 2007. So this idea of, you know, and it's connected to your question, what can we learn if we are Muslim brothers, I mean, today in terms of political experience? Has our political or institutionalization process been successful or not? Should we develop it or not? Should we go for another strategy or should we reinforce our democratization, option? Did I answer your question?
Well, unfortunately, I got to be a bad guy. Unfortunately, whether
I'll talk to you after.
Yeah, unfortunately, I have to be the bad guy. Fast, I'm getting bad signs. I'm fast. I really want to thank both Mark and Mohammed for their presentations. It was a lovely conversation. Thank you for coming. Hope you can join me in thanking the two of them.